Hey friends, and welcome to the show. My name is Mark James, and welcome to Livestream Lockdown, episode 3. We are back again, and it is nice to see you all here. Thank you for joining me again. If you've watched this every single week, as I always say, it means the world to me. I hope that you're enjoying this little bit of entertainment that I'm providing. So, let's talk about what's on the show. No camera problems this week. Everything is working out just fine. Give me a shout out. Say hello in the comments if you want me to say hello and give you a little shout out. And I will read those out as they appear. Hello to Michael, who's watching. Hello to Katie. And hello to Abs as well, who are watching. And Amanda. You guys have messaged in the comments. So please drop a message and I will say hello. Let's tell you what's on the show. This week we've got some great guests. We have Andrew and Steph, otherwise known as Ginny and the Tonic. They are absolutely great musicians, and they're going to be coming on to sing and perform for us live. They sing and play the piano, and it is going to be amazing. Then my headline interview guest is Mr. Steve Royal. If you watched Britain's Got Talent, not this weekend, but the weekend before, you will have seen him absolutely smash his audition. We're going to be talking to him about his life, his career in show business, and his brand new Britain's Got Talent journey. So that is going to be very exciting too. Steve's a good friend of mine. We work together in a pantomime, which we'll talk about later in the show. And I'm looking forward to chatting to him with all of you guys. Hello to Phil Phillips. Hello to David Walsh. Hello to Chris Black, and hello to Pauline, my mum. Hello, Paul, as well. 3, 2, 1. That's like the old, like this, isn't it? 3, 2, 1. We're ready to go. There you go. 3, 2, 1. So that's the guests. I'm going to be sharing some magic, an exclusive look at a show that I did in Ohio, which I'll talk to you about in a second before I play the clip. Hey, David, for saying hello there. I'm doing a new feature called The Vinyl Countdown, where we'll talk a little bit about music. We have prizes. We have the quiz. Of course, tonight, the quiz prize is, again, one of these, a Mark James Modern Magic mug, as every week. To my winner last week, I just posted yours today. Sorry it took so long, but what with the old isolation and stuff, I waited until I had a little bit of post to send. But I've got some more posts for tomorrow, so if you win this tonight, it'll be going out with tomorrow's post. So that's the box for the mug, and there is the mug itself. You can, I'm drinking a Pepsi Max out of this. Other drinks are available, but there's the mug. So if you win the quiz tonight, you get yourself one of these, and all of the answers to the quiz are in the show. So make sure you watch the whole thing. You'll find out everything that's going to be, all of the answers for the quiz are in tonight's show. So make sure you watch the whole thing. You will not miss out. Let me see if I've got some more shout outs. I do. Hello to Helen Wynn. Hi. Hello to Wilson Black, Ginny and the Tonic on the same night, Mother Hen. Oh, you saw them. If you saw the show, I'll tell you about how I met them in a second. Hello to Gareth Cole. Hiya, mate. Phil Reed wants a mug. Yeah, I'll bet he does. How much? Special prize for you, mate. Double. Right, so they're the prizes. Hello, Mel. Ah, good. Mel, it'll be with you tomorrow. I sent it first class, so you should receive it soon. Right, let's talk about the magic that I'm going to share before we link up with our first guest. So, 2 months ago, I went to Ohio and I filmed a brand new lecture for this big company called Penguin Magic. Now, Penguin Magic, they are one of the biggest magic companies, and they have performers fly to Ohio. You film a show, an hour-long show or half an hour or whatever it is, and then you explain the whole show afterwards. They just sent me the footage of my performance, and I cut one of the tricks out, and they said that I could use it for self-promotion or to share the lecture. So I've taken one trick that I want to share with you guys, and I hope that you enjoy it. Helen's just said about the tie. It's a tie. Hey to Laura. Hey to Matt. Hi, mate. That's my next-door neighbour there. The first week I did the show, I showed you my cup and ball trick, and then last week I showed you the egg trick, and this week I'm going to share something which is a little creepy and unusual. It is a trick based on the movie Bird Box, which was on Netflix, and I loved it, and I first performed it in America at the Magic Castle, and now it's in my new lecture, which is coming out. You're only going to see the performance part, of course, but I hope you enjoy it. One of the questions in the quiz is going to be about it, so make sure you're paying attention. Here comes the trick, and we'll be back after this with our first guests.
Hello?
Hello?
Hello, is anybody there?
Yes.
Where are you?
I'm right here. So this is a trick about a movie, a book called Bird Box. If you've seen this movie or read this book, please raise your hand. I have no idea if anybody just did that. So in case you haven't seen it already, let me tell you about it. It is called Bird Box and it is about fear. It is about confronting your fear or being so afraid to that we wear blindfolds, metaphorical and physical. My biggest fear is getting a trick wrong here in the Penguin Live studio. That would really suck. So tonight I'm going to give myself three chances to get it right using this book. I'm going to have people choose words. If you choose a word, I'd like you to remember it. I'm going to see if I can get it a little bit later on. This is how we choose the word. I will flick down the corner of the book. Whenever you want, please say stop if you are helping. All I'd like you to do is remember the very first word on that page. If you can't see a word on that page because it's a new chapter, tell me to move on and you can have a different page. It's no problem. But please make sure you remember that first word. No others. I'll come back to you soon. For now, if everyone could please put their hands out in front of them like this, because I'm going to walk over to you with my hands out. I've heard America can be quite litigious and I don't want to get sued, so. Keep those hands out for me. Okay, whose arm is this?
Andrew's.
Girl. Please say stop.
Stop.
Please remember the first word on the page. Do you have it?
Yeah.
Thank you so much. Everyone, please place your arms out again. Who is this? Girl. Please say stop. Do you need glasses, did you say?
She does.
Okay. It's okay, put them on.
Okay, they're on.
You got them?
Yeah.
Please say stop. Okay, please remember the first word on the page. Do you have it? You still got your glasses on and you've read it?
Yes, I'm good.
Good, okay, thank you. Please place your hands out again. Who is this?
Boy.
Please say stop. Please remember the word on the page. Do you have it? Great, thank you so much. The three people who are currently thinking of words, could you please stand up for a moment? Okay, I'd like you to join me by staying where you are, but by being blindfolded. The easiest way for you to do that is by closing your eyes. Please close your eyes and just dip your heads and listen very, very carefully. I'm going to say three words. Don't do anything yet. Just listen to whether or not I say your word. The first word I'm going to go for is, it's a word that we don't really use in the UK. We say it differently. Like we say mummy, but you say mommy. That's the first one. Mommy. The second word is special. I'm not sure. Maybe special. The third word, with. Keep your eyes closed. If I just said your word, please sit down. Did everybody sit down?
No.
How many people are still standing?
One.
Boy or girl?
Girl.
Is it Kelly?
Yes.
Kelly, I didn't quite get your word, did I?
No.
Please open your eyes, sit down for me.
Okay.
Kelly, what was your word?
Science.
Oh, I thought it was special. It's very similar letter-wise, which means I messed it up. Trick went wrong. My biggest fear came true. And yet I look around and I see all of you here inside of this theater watching a magic show that you came to and you knew that it was going to be a magic show. That's great, right? So if anything, this isn't a nightmare, it's a dream. And in dreams, things always come true. So the word you were looking for was science. So I didn't need to be afraid. All I needed to do was take off my blindfold and... Science! We did it! So friends, there was a little bit of magic from the My Show back in Ohio a couple of months ago. I hope you enjoyed it. That's an exclusive look. Nobody has ever seen that clip before, and it will be part of the lecture that will be coming out on May the 10th. If you are a magician and you know about penguin magic, you can get the rest of the show and the lecture then. So we are about to welcome on my guests. Folks, please put your hands together and welcome Steph and Andrew from Ginny and the Tonic. Hey, guys.
Hello.
How are you both?
We're good. Very excited.
Pleasure to have you on the show. Thank you for coming on. So you guys, you're in there together. Shouldn't you be isolating? How have you managed to be in the same house? I don't understand.
Well as being a musical duo, we are in fact a real life couple as well.
A real life couple as well. Good. Yes.
And so we're allowed to break that rule.
So you live together, work together, and I mean that must be fun, right?
It really is. Yeah, in fact, on Friday is our 10-year anniversary.
10 years? I think that's a glockenspiel and an applause. Yes. Congratulations. So we worked together in, where did we work together? What was the, which town?
It was October last year and it was in Ayr.
Yeah.
In Ayr, that's right, yeah. The Gaiety Theatre as part of Billy Reid's show. I know Billy's watching, so hello, Billy.
Hi, Billy.
And our audience will have heard you sing before because you sang last week on Billy's Trick, Caledonia, the card trick.
That's right, with Billy's amended wonderful lyrics.
Yeah. Well, we cannot wait to hear you sing again. So, what are you going to sing for us?
We're going to start with something upbeat and fun for you all. We're going to do some Hall & Oates for you.
Oh, amazing. I love Hall & Oates. Well, you guys are about to make my dreams come true. So, take it away. Wow, guys, that was amazing. Thanks so much, and great stuff. Like, so nice to hear you guys playing that, and tons of great comments coming in through that as well, which appeared onto the screen. Billy Reid says, Bunky on keys, smashing it. And Laura says, that was ace. So there you go, guys. Thanks so much for coming on, and you'll be back with another song at the end of the show, right? Until then, guys, thank you so much. See you again. Wow, how good was that to have those guys on? Absolutely brilliant musicians. So much fun. Cannot wait to have them back. They will be back at the end of the show. Very exciting stuff. Now it is time for a brand new feature. I need to get this. And I need to get this. Because the feature is called the Vinyl Countdown. Here we go. The Vinyl Countdown, yes. So I thought this would be a fun thing to chat about a bit of music. And the reason is that it's Record Store Day in the UK. Thank you to all the laughs that are coming in. Ha, 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 ha. That was ace. Yes, it was. So it is Record Store Day, or at least it was Record Store Day this week. So I thought what I'd like to do is take a couple of minutes out. I'm a huge collector of vinyl records. And I really, like, truly, you know, a huge, it's the main thing that I buy. So I thought I'd like to share some of my favorites with you. And if it's popular, I'll chat about two new records every single week. If you don't collect vinyl, it's a nice way to make music kind of interactive as opposed to just sticking on Spotify. So, Mark Layton, my manager, laughs. He's no doubt worried that my career is on a severe downturn now that I'm playing the ukulele. I'm doing shows online for free. So there you go, vinyl countdown. Here we go. So let's talk about the 10 records without further ado. Record number one, this, Little Fictions by Elbow. This is in at number 10. Favorite track on here is probably Kindling. So check that out, Little Fictions by Elbow. You can go back and buy all of these or look them up on Spotify if you want. In at number 9, Aretha Franklin, the electrifying Aretha Franklin. My favorite song on here has got to be Accentuate the Positive. You got to accentuate the positive. So that's a bit of Aretha. In at number 8, James Bay, Chaos and the Calm. This is an absolute banger. I listen to this almost every day since the first time I ever heard it, and I love it. In at number 7, Taylor Swift. I think that these might be... These are coming out backwards for you, are they? Yeah, they are. They look backwards on the screen because the camera flips it. Never mind. So Taylor Swift, 1989. This is an absolutely great album. My favorite song on here has got to be All You Had to Do Was Stay. I got into this album because Ryan Adams covered it, and I loved his cover of the whole album. And then I listened to the original Taylor Swift one, and I liked it more. So there you go. That's Taylor Swift. In at number, are we at 6? Jason Isbell, Southeastern. This is an absolutely great album. Best song on here, Cover Me Up. If you're going to look up Jason Isbell, make sure you check out Live at the Ryman as well. I don't have it on vinyl, but it is on vinyl, but it's on Spotify, so you can hear it there. Jason Isbell, Live at the Ryman. In at number 7, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3. In at number 4, Jim Jefferies, Bear. This is a comedy album. A double as well. There's two records in here because it's quite a long old gig. If you don't listen to vinyl or you're a big comedy fan, what you might not know is that a lot of different comedians put stuff out on vinyl record that they don't release anywhere else. You can only get it on record. Jim Jefferies is one of my favorite comedians. If you've seen that clip of him talking about gun control, which went viral and was super funny, it is from this record, and it's very funny on vinyl. Now, speaking of albums that only exist on vinyl, of comedians, here's one. Bill Burr, my absolute favourite comedian. Matt's just said, I'm mirroring my image. Yes, I know, buddy. I need to work out how to flip that round. I noticed it the other week and forgot. But there you go. So this is Live at Andrew's House. Bill Burr is a great comedy album. It's some stuff that he's done on his specials, if you've seen any of his specials. But this is a slightly different recording. It's a really great album. And as far as I'm aware, it only exists on vinyl. So that is for the vinyl fans. Next up, we've got this. Ray Charles, The Atlantic Recordings. This is a box set vinyl. I love these box set vinyls because you get a ton of records in. The Beatles have got these and loads of others. But you get like 8 records in here, and it is all of the songs that Ray Charles recorded while he was on Atlantic Records. So check that out. We're on the last two, the final two. It was hard to pick the top spot. John Mayer is in second place here. John Mayer, live in Los Angeles. If you like John Mayer, you've got to check this out. The recording of Gravity is the best recording of it I've ever heard. The solo is insane. I listen to it every day, no kidding, first thing out of bed. It's top of my playlist. I play this playlist in the house on Spotify. It plays through the whole house, and the solo here always hits by the time I'm in the shower. It's my favorite bit. So there's quite a few records in there for this one. It's a big old gig. So check that out. John Mayer, live in Los Angeles. And last but not least, in the top spot, Ryan Adams, live at Carnegie Hall. This is my absolute favorite. This is the one thing that I always listen to specifically on vinyl. It sounds great on Spotify. It sounds great in all the other places, CD and everything, you can get it. There's just something. Sarah just commented 5 times a day. She's not kidding. This on vinyl sounds brilliant. Something about it just makes it seem like he's in the room, and it's really good. So you get it performed for 2 nights And you get both recordings, night one and night two. They're both in there. And he did slightly different songs on the two nights, so it is well worth checking out. So that is Ryan Adams live at Carnegie Hall. Guys, that was the end of the vinyl countdown. I can tell you all want it, so I'm going to play the song again. As we say goodbye to the vinyl countdown. There you go. I did a lot better the second time. Had a bit of practice. So there we go. The time is 8:20, which means it is time to get ready to bring on our next guest. Very exciting stuff. Before we bring on our guest, a couple of weeks ago on the show, one of the first things that somebody asked, by the way, thank you to everyone commenting, hey Jenny, saw me on the Morella cruise ship, that's very nice. She's a big fan of mine. I'm going to put that on screen. Whoa, big fan. I've only got one, so thanks Jenny. Make it stop, Gareth says, about the ukulele solo. Laura is laughing. That's good. Okay, so, guys, before I bring on the next guest, a few weeks ago, I was doing the show, and someone said, talk about when you used to be a singer. You won't believe this, but I used to be a singer. I used to work for Haven, the entertainment company, and once upon a time, they had show teams on all of their parks. Obviously, it's very difficult to find, the amount of male vocalists required, so every now and again, not very often, but every now and again, a singer who isn't quite up to par slips through the net. And that person was me. I auditioned playing the guitar and singing, so I was able to look like a better singer than I was. And I got away with it, and I got the gig, and I did this job for 2 years. So I'm going to give you a minute and a half of that footage now, where you'll see me singing in a few different numbers from those shows. I've never aired this before, so I hope that you enjoy it. Right after this, we're coming back to chat with Mr. Steve Royal. Enjoy the footage.
Passing the lighthouse. She's the one that almost turns me off. The sexy angel falling from heaven. She's the one that always drives me wild and in a rush of dread forever. I see it for me, ya como día. Pero es veneno, si te quieres y no mara. Down. Walk like a loaded man. And bring, get you what's my name. With the rain, I've a smile on my face. I've tried so not to give in. I have said to myself this event's never gonna go so well.
So there was the video of me as a singer. To all of the comments that have been flooding in, yes, I was only 18. Why couldn't Rory the Tiger make it stop? I don't know. It was past his bedtime when the shows happened. You do karaoke as a cheesy DJ. You've done a lot worse. Michael, I can well believe it. Phil, yes, you are right. It was at Lakelands. Thank God you're good at magic. Thanks, Billy. I appreciate that. Let's have a round of applause for that comment. Right, friends, it is time to welcome on my good buddy and our second interview, our headline interview. He's all set up and ready. Please put your hands together, Mr. Steve Royal. Hi, Steve.
Thank you very much. Thank you. You had me worried then because I was listening to, I could only hear that music in the background going, oh, this singer's bloody terrible. I think I better not say anything. I don't want to offend him. He's a friend of yours, but it's you, so.
It was me. Yeah.
You chose the right career, mate.
Thank you,
mate. I can see why you went into magic.
Well, Steve, you and I have worked together in the past, so you've heard me sing.
Yeah. So I tell you what, you was that before? That was before you sang with us, wasn't it?
That was before I sang with you, yeah. That's why I wasn't allowed many lines.
Okay, that's fair enough.
So, Steve, everybody watching this will no doubt recognise you from last weekend, where they saw you burst onto the screen in Britain's Got Talent.
I've even, just so to reiterate it, I've worn the shirt.
Just in case.
Just so that you know, this is the actual shirt that I wear, or that I wore. And I've been wearing it every walk. I've been on just to try and get recognised more.
Really?
Because that's the only thing I missed. Because you go on Britain's Got Talent, how many million, especially at the moment, like 15 to 20 million people watching.
Yeah.
And yeah, I can't go out. The only way I can get recognised. The kids, obviously, every day, they want to say, can we go for a walk? Can we get out of the house? And I live in the countryside. It's quite reclusive around here, really.
Yeah.
Which is a shame. So I'm desperate to just go and walk around housing estates and things like that and just wave at people just to get some of that recognition.
Yeah. Maybe you should walk around with the ping pong balls in your mouth and throwing guitars and see what happens.
Yeah, as well, yeah.
So, Steve, when we met, we were in a panto together, and you've been doing panto. Tell us about your panto career. How did it start, and where are you now?
Do you know what? I think at the end of this year, see, that I'm losing count myself. It will be my 23rd, I think, 23rd pantomime this Christmas, assuming theatres are opening by then.
Let's fingers crossed, eh? Gosh,
Christmas. Yeah, back at the Grand Theatre. My first one I did was at the Southport Theatre, the Floral Pavilion, which was for Dougie Chapman Productions.
Yeah.
Lovely guy. I don't know if you ever remember Dougie Chapman.
I did, no longer with him.
He was a legendary local, well, Blackpool empresario, and he put on a lot of night old musicals, but he did a lot of pantomime as well, and he gave me my break. And you know what? I've never looked back. It's been brilliant. I love it. It's my favourite time of year. That I did the first year there. Then I did 4 years at Preston. And then ever since then, I've been at the Blackpool Grand Theatre for 18 years, man. Yeah. 18 years.
Well, it's funny because I think now with Britain's Got Talent, you're going to start getting recognised all over the place. But, I mean, I've walked around Blackpool with you and people recognise you just as much now already. You're like a, you know, huge celebrity in Lancashire. Everyone knows who you are now.
I know that was the weird thing about going on Britain's Got Talent, really, because people who know me are going, yeah, but you're already established, you're already... But they forget that, really, outside of the Northwest, you know, I certainly don't get the same recognition, but I'm pandered for that for quite some time to just get a little bit more exposure.
Yeah.
And I think there's a false idea behind Britain's Got Talent that it's just for, you know, wannabe stars who've never appeared, you know, never done anything live before, you know. And they do, there are great stories, like the one this week of the girl who's a nurse, fantastic, and that singing, she was absolutely awesome.
Yeah.
But it's also about giving people who've, you know, people like myself, I mean, I'm 51 now, people don't look like that. Certainly TV executives don't look to anyone like me to promote on television. So it's kind of just... Yeah, I just wanted to kickstart my career again, really. Chose the wrong year to do it, didn't I?
Yeah, now we're all in the house. So, Steve, before you went on Britain's Got Talent, which is obviously a massive gig, tell us about some of the biggest gigs that you did prior to that.
Oh, well, the first one that springs to mind would be the Live at the Palladium. Live at the Palladium about 5-6 years ago. There's a good story behind this, because I turned up, I was doing the warm-up, Jason Manford was the host, and he asked if I could do the warm-up for him, and I've done a lot of TV warm-up and stuff, so I went down, and it was at the, you know, to be at the Palladium. I thought, this is, what a great opportunity, so I turned up, and I parked my car just outside of London to get the tube into the theatre, and as I did, Jason phoned me up and says, look, Steve, have you got all your juggling gear with me? I said, it's in the car, I can go back and get it. He said, go and get it. One of our acrobats for the show has injured themselves. We need an act. You can be in it. I'm thinking, oh, this is awesome. This is amazing. So I went back, got all my stuff, went on stage. And then at the very beginning, Jason went on, introduced me to do a quick 5-6 minute piece. And hopefully they're going to use it. He said, we will hopefully use this in the actual show. But then I did it. They filmed it. It looked great. I was dead pleased. Everyone was patting on my back. Well done, Steve. And then Jason started the actual show. I did a bit of a warm-up. Jason started the actual show. And then he picked on this guy in the front row. And he happened to pick on a guy who had a pack of cards with him and was a magician.
His name's Henry White. I know the guy you mean.
Henry White. You know this guy.
Yeah.
You know, thanks to him. Can you pass the message on that he scuppered my career?
Well, I didn't know the story from your side because I saw it on Henry's Facebook saying, I can't believe I went to see the show tonight. I got picked to go up on stage. I performed a trick. It's going to be on the telly. And so I thought, well done for him. And I didn't know that that came at the cost of you being on the telly.
Yeah, it was funny because I was backstage. I was stood right next to the producers, actually. And they were watching. And I looked at him and went, well, he's just scuppered my chances. Because it was just totally chance and fluke. And Jason's great when he, you know, working off people like that. And it just that happened to get him out the audience. And as it happened, I knew straight away that I'd be binned. But what he was kind enough to do was send me some of the footage. And, you know, I've got some of the footage from that appearance now.
Well, Steve, I've cut together a little bit of that footage. So we're going to take a look at 40 seconds of you performing live at the Palladium now. So at last,
all right, okay,
that footage is getting the big audience it's been waiting for. So let's take a look at it now. 40 seconds of footage. Okay. This is Steve live at the Palladium.
Steve Royal! Oh, don't clap. I forgot. There used to be two of us.
Well, Steve, it looked like a hell of a gig.
Oh, it was. I mean, that theatre's amazing. Funny enough, I was so lucky to perform on that show. Who else was on that one? There was, I'll tell you who there was. Earth, Wind and Fire.
Really?
Yeah, met them all. I met them all, right? I met Earth and I met Fire, but I just passed Wind in the corridor. Thank you.
Whoa, we're getting an applause in. Hold on. There we go.
And then a month after that gig, yeah, within 6 weeks anyway, I was back at the Palladium doing a gig with Rob Brydon and the legend that is Neil Diamond. I was the warm-up on that.
Wow.
Which is amazing. I've not done it since or before. You know, twice within a couple of months I performed at the Palladium, which is brilliant. And then my other great, you know, the only way that was trumped in terms of gigs was when I was with the Phoenix Knights live team. And we performed at Manchester Evening News Arena for 15 nights.
Yeah.
15 nights 5 years ago and 15,000 people a night. It was just amazing. I mean, that was by far the just greatest. First of all, they're all my mates anyway. I work with them all on the circuit. I know them all. So to go down into Manchester with your good friends, perform a show, all have a meal together and all the drinking after. It was just an incredible time. Picked up by a limo at the door. Kind of just stressed though, none of us were paid. The main cast weren't being paid for that.
What?
So we were all bitter at the time. We raised over £5 million for Comic Relief that year. So it was, well worth doing.
Well, I remember when I was like 17 or 18 and I first moved away to work at Haven, and my entertainment manager put on a DVD and she's like, you've got to see this comedian, and it was Peter Kay. And it was live at the Bolton Harbour Halls. And I remember thinking, God, like, I didn't know comedy could be like this, you know, someone just being so themselves and stuff. And so Peter became a big hero of mine. And then working with you in Panto, I remember one day popping down to your dressing room in my boxer shorts and T-shirt to ask if you had something. And Peter Kay sitting in your dressing room.
You know what? He's been so supportive. And he's been dead supportive throughout the whole... he was one of the few people I told about doing... The Britain's Got Talent, and he's just brilliant. He's always thought about me and everything he's done. You know, I've had a little bits here and there and everything. Even in the last series of Car Share, I was one of his mates on the radio in that episode. So yeah, he's brilliant. He always comes to Panto. He loves Panto.
Yeah,
he's a big family man. You see, his family come first, and he looks after his lads there, and they all come down. So he's been to every Panto I've done for the last 5-6 years.
Yeah. Well, Steve, Gareth has commented, Gareth Cole. I think you know Gareth. He says
Gareth, yeah.
He hopes the remote control submarine is getting plenty of use in lockdown. So that's a little allusion to some of your material in the show. I'm hoping we'll see that on Britain's Got Talent.
Do you know what? I might well do. I might well put that into the, you know, if I get through to the semi-finals, which I don't know yet, but when I do, or if I do, I might put that line in. Yeah, so I won't ruin it for you now.
Yeah. Well, Steve, I will be absolutely calling in and voting for you and wishing you luck, and I really hope you do well. I mean, to see someone like you who I've known for so many years and worked with and, you know the talent and what a nice guy you are behind it, you're the sort of person that we really hoped as well. So good luck, mate. I hope everyone votes for you.
And likewise, mate, you keep going because it sounds like you're doing great, especially in America. That clip before looked brilliant. I did catch you a little bit. That looked really good.
Oh, thanks, mate. We should tell them, actually. We tell them about the time when I had to try and fill your boots in Panto. Do you remember this?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I was talking to someone about this the other day. I was talking to someone about, I think they asked me if I ever, you know, missed the performance. And that was a clip. Traffic was really bad one morning. We had an early show, didn't we, for schools.
Traffic was really bad, yeah.
I'd set off like a normal, good time at 7:30, but the motorway was chock. I'd come from Chorley to Blackpool.
Yeah.
You were already at the theatre, and basically there's no way I was going to make the start of the show.
Yeah,
and you, as I recall, you went on and just started padding and filling.
Yeah, so I'd been
a trick and I arrived in there.
Yeah, so I'd been principal comic, which for those who know about Panto is like the lead, you know, speaks to the audience role, which you always play. I'd been that role before for the company, but I stepped down from it to work with you and to work nearer to home in Blackpool. And I was played the policeman. And someone was understudying you if you were ill or couldn't make the show, and one of the male dancers. And yeah, I knew you weren't going to make it because we were texting. And everyone heard on the tannoy, I won't say his name, but could he please report to the prompt desk? And then 2 minutes later, could Mark James please come to the prompt desk? And everybody laughed because everyone knew he'd gone down and absolutely pooed his pants. And then they called for me to come down. So I went down.
You could have done it. It always makes me laugh that they always get one of the dancers.
Yeah.
The poor guy, there was a guy in this year who just said, "You won't be ill." He said, "Steve, you won't be ill. You won't be ill."
Yeah.
I usually just have a few bad coughs and a few snuffles whenever I'm around them. But
oh, it was so much fun.
You did brilliant. You did brilliant. Went on and then, as I recall, I literally walked in. They had my costume there.
Like, yeah.
At the stage door, I jumped into my pants and walked on.
Well, I'm chatting to the audience as the policeman. I'm doing magic tricks. I'm like trying to fill all the time. Constantly looking in the wings to see where you are. And then I see you in the wings, fully dressed, thumbs up like, oh, he's here. Now, I've done shows with you before, so I know you don't normally turn up until 11 seconds before you're on stage. But I see you in the wings, thumbs up, and I go, has anyone seen Wishy Washy? I'm going to go look for him. And I run off and you run on and nobody knew the difference.
No, it was seamless. You're right there. You would not have known. Apart from the fact that I gradually, because I hadn't put any makeup on, Panto makeup and that, I kind of built it up over the next few scenes.
Yeah.
So I have a couple of red cheeks and a little bit of eyeliner. Then by the end of Act One, I was fully made up.
Gosh. Good times, mate. Well, thanks for coming on the show. And I, along with everyone else, wish you massive luck. So, guys, please vote for Steve.
Thanks very much, Mark. All the very best to everyone.
Catch up with you soon, mate. Thank you. So, friends, there was Steve Royal, absolute legend of the Blackpool Panto. If you've been to see the Panto, you will have seen Steve before. He is brilliant. So please vote for him when the show comes out. If he makes it to the finals, I hope you'll vote for him because he really is the kind of act that we want to see doing so well. Great interview there, too. He was so fun to talk to. So, friends, we are about to welcome back our guests to sing for us again. But before we do that, it is time for the quiz. Now, Steve and I worked together in Aladdin, which was a super fun panto. You might have guessed from the wishy-washy comment that I mentioned before. And now we're going to do the quiz, okay? So, everything that you need to know was in the show so far. I've got to reiterate the rules before I put the quiz questions up. It is the first person that I see in my comments, because I know that when you comment yourselves, you see your own comment first and then you see other people's. So you think that you were the first person to answer, but that's not necessarily always the case. Just your own computer or phone will tell you that you answered first when it won't. So it's the first person to give me all of the answers correctly in a single comment, okay? So all five answers in a single comment. The first person that I see will win the prize. The prize, of course, is one of these mugs, a boxed Mark James mug. So I'm going to put the questions up now, and then I'm going to bring our guests on, and then after the guests, after Ginny and the Tonic sing, I will announce the winner. Get ready at your keypads. Here we go. The questions are coming up. Now, question one. Which book was my magic trick that I showed you at the beginning of the show based on? So which film or book was it based on? Question two. Which popular drink did my musical guests sound like? Question three. What was my number one vinyl record? That singer that I brought up is my absolute favourite. Who was it? You just got to give me his name. Okay, you don't have to have the full title. Question number four. Which TV show did Steve just appear on? A huge TV talent show. And question number five. I just gave you the answer. What was the pantomime that Steve and I did together? So they are the five questions right there. Which book was my trick based on? Which popular drink did the musical guest sound like? What was the number one vinyl record that I brought out? The last one that I brought out, the singer of that. Which TV show did Steve just appear on? And which pantomime was Steve and I in together? They are the five questions. I hope you are typing your answers now. And we are about to bring back our guests. So let me call them back up. Very exciting stuff. Here we go. I'm going to get them online. I'm making the call now, friends. Exciting stuff. Who will have won the quiz, though? Who knows? We've got some answers flying in already. Put the person who got it right onto the screen at the end of speaking to our guests. I've established them. Just need to get our video up, guys. There we go. Okay, so let's welcome back, folks, our dynamic duo. It is Ginny and the Tonic.
Hello.
Hey, guys. Absolutely delighted to have you back. What have you prepared for us for your second song?
Well, we thought we would do something a little more heartfelt than the first song. So we're going to do some Beach Boys, God Only Knows.
Perfect. I absolutely can't wait. Folks, here they are one more time. It is Ginny and the Tonic. Take it away, friends.
Thanks again, Mark.
Thank you.
Thanks,
Wow, how good was that? So, friends, there are the social media links there to Ginny and the Tonic up on the screen right now. If you want to check them out, you can see them. www.ginnyandthetonic.com and also Ginny at Ginny and the Tonic. That is on Instagram and other social media. Please do check them out there. Okay, so apparently we're having a little bit of a sound issue. Hopefully it resolves itself because I'm about to bring on our... We're going to find out who our winner is. So here we go. Let's go back to the to finding out. Let me get back to the regular camera. Okay, here we go. So I'm going to put the person who won up onto the screen with their answers. The first person to send the answers in and win. And that person is Laura. Congratulations to Laura, who won the mug. Well done, Laura. This is winging its way to you tomorrow. So I hope you enjoy drinking out of it. If you've won a mug the first week, Ryan, who won one, and to Mel when you get yours tomorrow, and to Laura when you get this, please post a picture of you or send me a picture of you drinking out of it, and I will share them along with previous winners. That will be super fun. So congratulations, Laura, for winning tonight's quiz. Well, friends, that does bring us to the end of the show. I really do hope you enjoyed it. We've just hit exactly 45 minutes, which is what I wanted to do. I hope you enjoyed the guests. Thank you to Ginny on the Tonic. Thank you to Steve Royal at Steve Royal Comic on social media. Please vote for him. I hope you enjoyed the vinyl countdown, the quiz, the prizes, and my little bit of magic with the Bird Box trick as well. That is another show over and done with. Thank you to everyone who tried to get in with the quiz. Phil says that it's a fix. Sorry, Phil, you were so close, but you put Ray Adams, not Ryan Adams, but it was a good shout. I mean, you did well. Whoop whoop, Laura says, and thank you for being the winner. There you go. Thanks, Mark. Another great show. Thank you, Simon. I appreciate that. Guys, that is the end of our show. Thank you to Billy. I really do hope that you had a great time and enjoyed it. I'll be back next week. I've got two more great guests that I can't wait to introduce you to. More of a few new features that I'm going to come up with. And while we're all in lockdown, I'm going to try and make this show every single week. So please keep sharing. Please keep watching. I'll be back at 8 p.m. next Monday. I will see you all then, friends. I'm just going to throw a couple more comments up. Great show, mate. See you next week. Thanks, Phil. Rounds of applause from Billy. Stay safe. See you next week. Nice work. Guys, thank you so much. You are all awesome. Catch you next Monday, 8 o'clock.